Unbelievable. I am back. Hey, listen, I am back. This is Vader Percussion. I keep on coming back like a bad rash. I am back here again because we have more people to present to you, and I'm so glad and so honored to have this opportunity. This is so fantastic with all these different interviews that we had. We had last week, we had Mike Mangini, and we're going to bring him back again. And we just have an incredible amount of variety of artists that we have. But I want to talk about next week. Next week, March 9th. This is going to be great. Drum techs. We're going to catch up with three of the well-known drum techs in the industry to get their take on working hand in hand with this long list of incredible legends. Joining us will be Mike Ledesma, John McGarry, and Tim Sawyer Soyan. Mike has been working the past few years with Cindy Blackman Santana. McGee has spent 15 plus years in various roles with Aerosmith, and Sawyer has been working with Primus since the late 80s. These three guys have worked with so many other great names. You'll get to know how to make it all happen. They'll be here with lots of great stories, insight, and fun for all. So join us next week on March 9th. This will be absolutely fantastic. Now, this next gentleman that I want to bring on with actually his drum tech, Jamo, this is going to be fantastic. But I want to play a video for you first. This is Tony Escapa playing in his studio. And what I want you to watch is this is totally interesting that he's got some sound effects that he's playing with. And I want you to see the creative process of how he plays with these sound effects and how his groove changes. Check it out. Feel what he's doing. Check out Tony Escapa. Fantastic. What a great groove. What great sound effects. Brilliant, brilliant creativity. Tony, thanks so much. Please welcome Mr. Tony Escapa. Bring him on here, Tony. This is great, fantastic. Thank you so much for joining us.
Oh my God, I'm so honored to be here, Dom. You don't even know, man.
You know, Tony, you are playing so great. Between Ricky Martin, between Al DiMeola, David Sanchez, Franco De Vita, you've got some acts that you have played with that you have been a driving force, and it is just so intense. And not only with the drumming end of it, but the massive, whether it's sequencing, whether it's dance, there's so much that's going on that you have to stay focused on. It's great to have you here. Thanks so much.
It's great to be here, man. Great to be here. And thanks for that.
Really, well played and well done. And also what I want to bring on, your drum tech that's been assisting you, this guy is a whole nother, you know, world in his own. He goes back many, many years. I've known Jamo for many, many years. Please welcome Jamo as an incredible drum tech that is the assistance of what Tony is doing. Jamo, you there?
I am. How are
Yeah.
y'all? Yeah. Nice to see you guys.
Fantastic, Jamo. Thanks so much for joining us. You know, this is thanks what we do so well at Vater is the fact that we bring these different topics in of not only what Tony is doing, but also, Jamo, what you have to do to support him, to give him the tools he needs to do what he does.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a full-time gig for sure. I mean, we wake up, we call each other, and we talk about gear and what we want to change or what we want to try. And we're in there way before the shows, making sure everything's right and he's comfortable and he can pull off that show, because it's not easy. That's a lot of stuff going on. Like you said, sequencing, everything, the whole dance stuff. I mean, it's a lot of stuff that falls on his plate.
Well, it really is. Tony, I got to ask you, you went to Berkeley, which is incredible, and you've got some marching background that you have also.
I do, man. I went to high school in Florida. You know, I'm from Puerto Rico, born and raised, but at some point my father decided to move to Florida. I was 13, 14, and I had never been exposed to marching music. And it was at that time where I was living in Florida that I came in contact with that artistry. And I was completely overwhelmed. I loved it. I thought it was an incredible experience, you know, and I really got into it. The whole DCI drum corps thing too. I was super into it. And it was a great foundation as a drummer. This helped me throughout my career.
So you were into the school marching band? Is that where it started?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it started when I was in ninth grade and when I moved to Florida, and I was in the marching band. I was also in the jazz band. I also played with lots of local bands. My father is a musician too. So I was always in the business sort of, and I was, you know, marching. The marching thing was really what got me. You know, I was really into it. I thought it was something to really take advantage of that I had never been exposed to when I moved out of Puerto Rico, because we don't have that here. I you know, it's not something that we really are exposed to. But as soon as I moved to Florida, that was one of the first things that I was just like, wow, what is this? I love it. And since it's so rudimental, and for us drummers, it's such a great foundation. I fell in love with it right away, and I was really into it.
So was this the beginning stage of where you started getting your chops together as far as your hand technique?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, I guess my drum teacher at the time may say otherwise. I mean, I did have chops. I played drums since I was 9 years old, and actually, my chops came from watching a lot of VHS videos of Buddy Rich, Dennis Chambers, Simon Phillips, all these guys. So I learned at a young age to practice at a pillow, you know, from watching these VHS videos. So at least my singles and doubles were great early on, you know. But when I got to high school and started doing the marching, that's when all the rudiment language really came to be something completely, like, way more involved, I guess.
So were you working out of any drum books at all? Was there stuff that you were working on?
You know, I did work in, for my whole career, I've always heard of either stick control, syncopation. I did work with the book called The New Breed for a minute too, on independence and stuff. I worked also on Horacio's clave book too. You know, all these books were always a part of obviously learning. But I'm mainly self-taught. I basically haven't spent as much time with books as I have with music and real time experience is what I'm trying to say, maybe.
But Tony, that's absolutely amazing, because you play so great. And Horacio's book is called Conversations in Clave.
Yes.
And it's really a great, great book to get. So the fact that you stepped into that, and Horacio's book is kind of like the new breed of Latin playing.
Yes, absolutely.
New breed kind of opens up your independence in rock and funk, and Horacio's books, those are powerful, you know, material.
Horacio sort of changed the game when he came out, you know, and I remember I was actually in Florida, and it was a completely different approach to drum playing and clave understanding and rhythmic playing. And I wasn't there, and when I saw him play with Santana, and he actually, I remember the Modern Drummer thing that he did in the beginning, and I was you know, I couldn't believe what I was seeing, and I was so into that, just like a lot of other drummers, because being from Puerto Rico, being from the Caribbean, you know, Cuba has always been a very big influence, you know, and also Puerto Rico, we have a lot of rhythmic influence, but we have never been that into, you know, playing the clave like he was. It was something completely unique. So that book really was really important in understanding the whole Latin, you know, understanding subdivision in the clave, to really understand how to move around in different, you know, time signatures within the clave. So,
well, you know, Horacio has changed the game several times, and he's still changing the game. And anytime I go to perform with him, I tell him the only way I'm going to perform with Horacio is if he can't use his right hand or his left foot. We got to even the playing field in this process. So great guidance you had as far as, you know, being influenced by that for sure. So you've got your setup. Listen, Ricky Martin is an intense show. This is just an intense show of what it is. Let me quote Jamo. What kind of gear does Tony need to have in preparation for that kind of a show?
Well, he's got to have, you know, his drums. He's endorsed by DW, Paiste cymbals, Vater drumsticks, Remo heads, and all of it's got to be ready to go because it's a long gig, and there's no stopping the SMPTE code or the sequencer or the dancers or the gig to fix something. So it all has to be right.
Boy, that's so fantastic to hear because, I mean, that's got to give you a certain level of comfort, right, Tony?
Well, if he's there, I'm very comfortable. Trust me. I mean, he makes it. I sometimes, you know, he makes me feel way too comfortable, and I like to be on the edge sometimes. to keep me focused, you know, but when he's there, everything is just too easy. So I got to give him props for that.
Well, it's got to be that way, you know.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, as far as the gear, man, you know, I'm an easygoing guy when it comes to the gear. And as a matter of fact, my gear with Ricky Martin sort of evolved throughout the years. You know, I've been playing with Ricky for, you know, 16 years right now, you know. So in the beginning, you know, in the beginning it was something, and now I sort of wanted to create a new setup. And you know, the amount of music that we cover with Ricky, it's either we can go from rock to Latin to pop to dance, you know, electronic stuff, you know, you name it. So, but in at the core of it all, you know, and I think this is very important. At the core of all these approaches to music, there's this thing, which is what we drummers should do, which is to play that pocket, to make it feel good. And is, you know, I base my drum setup as a four piece, just 12, 16, kick and snare. And then from there, I sort of build, you know, if you look at a picture of my drum kit, you know, right now, that's basically what it's based off. Because for me, the simpler the better, as far as like what I'm playing, just because it helps me be more creative with less. But at the same time, you know, I gotta know how to play all these things that I have. There's a lot of colors, and you know. But again, it's just making it feel good, you know, and making it so that it's really full of energy, and you know, it's got to have that thing. And I guess that's what the core of it all is for me as a drummer.
Well, that's interesting. Jamo, are there any challenges that you know of that happen, that come up when you're teching for someone like Tony? You know, are there any obstacles or challenges that happen last minute that you couldn't predict?
Yeah, there's like when we're overseas, there's always power issues or something like that. We have a mixer back by us, and we have a multi-pad that we have, and if something goes wrong, if somebody hits a button or unplugs something and plugs it back in, it can like destroy, you know, his monitors, and it could destroy the pad. And then, you know, a lot of that, like what he was saying, that's part of the colors that he has that goes along with that show. And if it's not there, it just doesn't feel right. So, you know, we got a couple of extra pads and mixers that we carry with us, but luckily, you know, we don't ever have any problems like that. Thank God. Knock on wood.
Actually, I mean, I remember a moment, but it was actually my mistake. I pressed the wrong button on the mixer accidentally, and the whole sound just went away, and I was screaming out of the top of my lungs, you know, like, what's going on? But anyway.
I remember one rehearsal. I think it might have been the last time that we played in Las Vegas, and we went through two mixer boards in like an hour.
Oh yeah.
For whatever reason, the software in the boards that we were using just all up and went. So thank God we got rid of that problem in rehearsal and didn't have that during the gig.
Yeah, absolutely.
Boy, this is fantastic, guys. You know, we have a variety of people that are tuning in from literally all around the world. And I've got a question I want to bring up right now. Let's bring up this question here. Jose Luis Gonzalez, a phenomenal drummer who I've had an opportunity of giving him some lessons. You know, I mean, look at this here. Any comments on the music scene in Puerto Rico for someone who is seeking a career in it?
Comments on the music scene in Puerto Rico, as far as what? I mean, the music scene, I'm going to actually speak for myself as far as like what I think of the music scene in Puerto Rico. The music scene as I grew up here has been really a fundamental school as far as like being exposed to what I do as a musician, you know, because we have everything, you know. Puerto Rico is so complete as far as like being exposed to so many styles of music, being jazz, being rock, you know. We have underground scene, we have stuff that happens in hotels, there's big concerts that happen, there's so much talent in Puerto Rico. And if you really want to be exposed to being an all-around musician, which is what I wanted to do when I graduated high school, I moved to Puerto Rico, and my goal was to move here because I knew that that's what I was going to get as far as experience, you know, a vast experience in different, types of music, folkloric music, the bomba and plena from Puerto Rico, salsa, you know, rock, anything, you name it, we have it here. So as far as commenting on the music scene, I think it's one of the best, you know, because you're able to see all this stuff. And it's legit, and it's and if you get around and you get some gigs, you're gonna be playing some great music. So I it's a great scene for sure.
Well, that's fantastic. Well, you know, listen, the music scene anywhere, once you kind of get into it and you start to meet the musicians and you start to get into the culture of what's happening, it's very exciting. But Jose, thanks, great question. Yeah. So a couple of things now. You're playing with Ricky Martin. This is like, you know, I think what blows me away is the playing to a click and having to make that feel so great, especially when there's dancers, which it needs to be at a specific tempo. How do you master that skill?
Oh, man. I only do it on the show. I don't practice to a click ever. I mean, we play to a click throughout the whole show. And the reason being is everything is synced. So lighting and everything is synced to the code, so there has to be a grid and the show runs on click. But as far as making it feel right, you know, I don't play to the click. I let, you know, the click, I mold to the click in a way, but it's like I'm playing on top of the click, you know. It's not I don't know how to say it, my feel, it's more important. So, you know, I have to say that when you play to a click, you really have a click is just a guide to sort of let you know where you are. But you move around in the click. You play, sometimes you push forward, sometimes you lay back, you know, and that's your feel playing on top of the click. The click is not going to control me, is what I'm trying to say. But subdividing is the most important thing, man. You got to really be able to subdivide and understand styles to move around from one thing to the other. And it's definitely I don't even think about it anymore. It's like second nature to me. You know, the click is just a guide to sort of show me the way, but I'm doing the show. I'm the one that, you know, people have to follow in a way when it comes to drumming. So,
well, interesting. So basically the click track for you is kind of a guide rail, and that guide rail just kind of keeps you in a place where you can dictate your feel. Are there any changes that Ricky may want during a show that he might turn to you? Are there any, you know, things that you might be prepared for?
Well, you have to always be prepared for anything. You know, you never know what's going to happen as far as the set list. You know, there's moments where we improvise with the set list, and he may add or take out a song or not. And you know, this show is so thought out. You know, we spent a lot of time figuring out the show prior to going on tour. So, you know, once the show is done, basically everything sort of stays the same. There's a section of the show where it's the point where we can improvise. And it's basically an acoustic ballads part that we play, that it's all rocked out, you know, and that's about it. Everything else goes to a click. There's also moments, like, for example, on this particular show, we're doing a version of this song called Vuelve that at the end we have a long guitar solo. And it's more of like an interaction between the band. And that's free. There's no click to that. We're playing, you know, to ourselves, which is a great feeling too, you know, because, I mean, there's nothing, I mean, more gratifying than being able to play without the click and making it feel great. I mean, the click is great. But at the same time, you know, the human element, it's what's important. So that's why, that's what I mean, that you can play metronomically, but it's, I'd rather listen to something more organic. And the click should be a guide. But, I mean, in the end, you know, the show sort of sticks to the same thing. Like I said, you know, Ricky would probably never come to me and be like, hey, can you change this up? Or, you know, because we basically figure it out. And once the show is going, it's going, because it's all basically the code. If we change anything, we would have to probably rearrange the show in a way.
Boy, this is so great that you have this level of freedom inside the discipline of the click and the sequencer. Jamo, you've got to be, you know, skilled at your own level. You're a phenomenal drummer. You're a teacher, and you know that level of what you bring to support Tony is a pretty powerful overview.
Well, I hope so. You know, I love the gig. I think it's wonderful. And Tony and I have been dear friends since 2008. I think our first gig was in Beirut. We were doing a wedding reception or something like that. but it was, you know, he is such a an amazing musician. And the styles that he brings into just this one show is a learning experience. So I like to think that I add to him, but he sure adds a lot to me, not only as a friend, but as a drummer, you know, trying to learn different things. His Latin playing is amazing, and his fusion hands are just crazy. So I always pick his brain every once in a while on a rudiment or a lick or something that he has, because he's a force for sure to be reckoned with.
Boy, it's amazing. Tony, these marching chops, and plus having gone to Berkeley, I mean, you really have developed a certain level of versatility. Listen, Ricky Martin is one thing. Al DiMeola is a whole nother world. And what's happening? So how did you develop this ability of versatility?
Man, it all comes to understanding music. You know, the time you spend really trying to get music. And like I said before, I think my upbringing has a lot to do with me being able to move around from different styles. You know, my father is also a musician, and he always talked about how important it is to be versatile when it comes to being a musician, because it'll give you longevity in the music world. You know, you'll be able to do all kinds of things and not just do one thing. And I really focused on that. But at the same time, it's important to me to legitimately play certain styles and types of music. And that involves sound, the instrument, you know, changing the instrument around, changing tuning. You know, I may use different types of cymbals for different sessions, you know, heavier or not, more lighter cymbals. And I'll use different types of drums depending on the style of music. But being versatile involves really understanding music, you know, understanding what elements make one thing work, so that you can really pinpoint, you know, the musicality of it, you know, and make it organically. Like when I play jazz, you know, it's one thing. I really try to go for that jazz sound, you know, be, you know, the tuning of the drums, you know, being the cymbals. When I play rock, I go for bigger drums, you know, more thumpier. And you know, I also play differently. You know, I don't think about it. It's something that I've worked on for a long time. And when I play Latin music, you know, I really you know, try to think as a section player, because when you're playing Latin music, you got to think of different musicians that are part of the percussion section, which is the timbales, the bongos, the congas, you know, and there's more elements. So you got to think differently, because it's not my show. We got to play as a section. And it's, you know, to me, the marching thing was also a great experience, because it helped me learn how to listen to other musicians. Because you, when you're playing in a drum line, you got to listen to your buddies, everybody around you, so you can play in unison. So it's sort of the same, you know, when you play in a Latin band, you know, with a conga, a timbale, and a bongo, you really have to listen to each other. You know, although it's a different language, but it's, you really got to listen and play together. So versatility, man, it's one of those things. I've worked on it for a long time, and I've been able to have opportunities to also put that stuff that I've learned to practice, you know. And I've never been shy, you know, of taking a gig. You know, like when Aldi Meola called me, I was just like, let's go. You know, I want to definitely experience it and see what it, you know, I may not be the guy, but I have to go at least. Let's play. Let's see if it feels good. And man, it's, if it works, it works. And if it doesn't, you know, there'll be something else, you know. So.
Well, that's actually a very healthy attitude to have, that, you know, if it doesn't work out, it just didn't work out. Not that big a deal. Move on. There's plenty of other opportunities out there. But, you know, your dad, as a professional musician, he played with a lot of big names in Puerto Rico. So you were exposed to this at a young age.
Yeah, man, I grew up in rehearsal spaces and concerts. If I tell you my, you know, since I was a little kid, I mean, one of the names that everybody knows, and it's sort of like an incredible thing, because I happen to be playing drums for Ricky Martin. But my dad was the keyboard player for Menudo in the band that Ricky was part of. Yeah. So I grew up, you know, in concerts my whole life. You know, I've seen this. I've been part of it for my whole life, you know. And it's funny, because my dad, he knew that I was musically inclined early on, but he really wanted to make a point that you have to really be serious about what you're doing, and you got to really make a decision and take it seriously. So my dad, you know, one time when we moved to Florida, he was just, you know, he made it really clear. He was like, do you really want to be a musician? Is this something that you want to do? Because if you're going to be a musician, well, jokingly, he said, you got to be better than me. what he meant was that he really wanted me to be serious and take this as a career. And he also was making sure that I understood what it took, because it's not easy. Yeah. You know, as musicians, as being a musician, it's not easy at all. You know, it's up and downs, and it's like you really have to adapt most of the time to whatever situation. Like, look at us now, we're in the middle of a pandemic, you know. Yeah. So it's adaptation and so on. But anyway, I was really lucky to have a dad for a musician, musician for dad, and he really helped me to focus and really take things seriously.
But what a powerful influence to have that at a young age, and just to be around the music all that time. This is like celebration every day.
It is, man.
It is fantastic. We have another question I want to pull up here. Let's pull this other question up here from Andy Thurston. Andy Thurston is a phenomenal drummer and teacher in Nottingham, UK. Student of mine, studied with many, many years. He's got a phenomenal teaching practice there. He's a great, great player. He says, hey, Tony, living in the UK, it can be hard to find opportunities to experience and study Latin music. What would you recommend students to start, both in listening and learning? Great question, Andy. Thanks.
Yeah, great question, man. You know what? When you start to learn a new style of music, I look at it as learning a language. And, you know, it's unfortunate now, because we are in a moment in time where basically we rely a lot on the internet, and that's basically about it, you know. To me, listening to the history of the music, it's really important. You got to go back. Like when I started studying jazz music, for example, or when I got into jazz drummers, I went back in the timeline, and I wanted to see who were the guys that started this thing and how it evolved. You really have to look at the history of it. But obviously, listening to the music is really important. I don't want to say get books, because, I mean, first you got to listen to the music, and that's really hard. I mean, maybe I can help you out to give you some pointers. But you know, in Latin music, you got to look at Cuba, you got to look at New York, you got to look at Puerto Rico. But there's also Dominican Republic. You know, there's so many different ways to start looking at it. But you know, Cuba is one of the most important, you know, elements in Latin music. You can also think of, you can also start by looking at the folklore of the particular place. And then you can move on to the styles of music. It's a process. It's really hard for me to even put it into words now, because it's, you know, it's so much history and information. But definitely listening to a lot of the music, it's really important.
So Tony, maybe a suggestion would be, and I'd love for this to happen, why don't you take on a few students during this pandemic, and we'll connect Andy to you, and through Zoom or whatever it is, start taking some of these students through a little bit of the history and patterns and just what you have done naturally through your heritage. I think this would be great for you to get out there and start sharing this stuff with each of these students.
Man, I agree 100%. Absolutely. We'll do that. You've got to find a way to connect with everybody, you know, and I'm active on social media. And like, you know, anybody that right now is seeing this and is interested in maybe getting involved in learning of Latin music or the history, absolutely hit me up on my Instagram, you know, and I would love to help out, you know, or Facebook.
Absolutely. So Andy Thurston from Nottingham, UK, you know, as I've guided you along the way for these years, I want you to go to the Instagram account, go to Tony Escapa, and tell him, Dom sent me, I want some lessons. Hook it up and step into the world of Latin music. Man, you'll be dancing in the streets after a couple lessons with Tony.
Or making people dance on the street, which is what we do.
Absolutely, man. Now, talking about education, which I'm so impressed. Jamo, you've got Rock Central, which is a nonprofit school that you've organized as a player, as an educator. Just talk about that, what you set up.
Yeah. Well, we started off as a franchise of School of Rock. One of the gentlemen that started it grew up in this area around the lake. And after that, after he graduated, he moved down to Chicago and started, he bought a couple franchises in Evanston and Highwood, Illinois. And his wife coaxed him into coming back up, home and starting a school up there. So we opened up a franchise, and we were probably in business probably, I don't know, a year and a half. It was a little bit tedious because our income in the wintertime coming into the school went down considerably. And then with that, we had to give the franchise like a certain amount of money off the top of our profits. So we really couldn't continue on. And the franchise in itself decided, well, we're not going to bother, you know, keeping it there. We're going to get rid of it and just wash it away. And us, myself and a couple other folks decided to try to restructure as a non-for-profit. That way we can, you know, dictate our own prices and do our own thing and not have a corporate entity kind of looking at us from overhead. So we've been in business for probably 6 years now, and moved to, we started off in a little 700 square foot shop, and now we're in a 2,200 square foot facility with two rehearsal facilities and probably 10 lesson rooms. And it's a lot of fun. So basically it's the same platform as School of Rock, where we go in and we pick a curriculum every 3 months. Right. And that could be like Aerosmith and Lynyrd Skynyrd or something. And then we teach these kids, you know, these particular songs. And then after the 3 months, we go book a gig at a club and they play it as their graduation. So once these kids start that process and they play their first gig, they're hooked. And I love that. Yeah. I love it.
Boy, it's amazing. Now, what's happened during the pandemic? How have you adapted to
it? Well, of course, you know, everybody just went on lockdown. So we had to figure out a way to do it. So we started doing Zoom meetings such as this. And for the most part, it worked out good. There were some kids that just like couldn't get into the whole virtual learning. And then in July, we opened back up into in-person, and there was only a couple of kids that wanted to stay with the virtual side of things just because they weren't quite sure, you know, how the COVID thing was going to work in the school. But we took on the precautions and made marks all over the floors, you know, where everybody should stand. And, you know, the drum sets and the drum room were spread apart 6 feet. You know, we just did our thing, and we had a bunch of PPE stuff and masks and, you know, the whole thing. And it worked out fine. Everybody seems to be doing fine. No one's gotten sick. So I'm grateful for that.
Well, that's fantastic that you've adapted for it. You know, and that's really the name of the game. Much like as musicians, we have to adapt to playing music. But as business people, we have to adapt to how to survive in this crazy world of this business that we're in. Let's bring another question up here. From Tony Durham, for a new gig, do you prefer pre-written charts or making your own charts? You like writing your own stuff out? Or how do you learn these tunes?
Man, you know what? I depends. You know, with a lot of the artists in the jazz world, you know, since these songs are so complicated, they will always bring a chart. I either read the piano chart or the bass part, or even sometimes some of the lead lines. Especially also in Latin music, you really have to rely on charts. And in the beginning, when I first joined Ricky Martin's band, they did bring out some charts. But at the end, we never use charts on stage. And actually, my personal way of doing it, I don't like to rely on the chart because it becomes like something that you need all the time if you learn by reading the chart. I always rather listen to the music and see if it's something that I can understand right off the bat without having to go to the charts. You know, because as drummers, depending on the style, we know what to look for in the music, when we start to learn the music. If I'm doing some, like a rock session or something, I will write out a chart just to know how to navigate the music. But usually I don't rely on charts because it's almost like, You're always going to need the chart there if you learn by reading a chart, you know. Thank God that we have MP3s and it's easy to send music. You know, back in the day, that wasn't the way to go. You would have to read a chart. Nowadays, usually I just get somebody to send me an MP3 or something. Or we can just even talk about it. And a lot of times, just talking about the vibe of the music, you know, it works and it really helps to understand where you're going. You sort of zoom in on a specific thing or vibe that you're looking for when you talk about vibes or, you know, sounds or whatever musicians that you're looking at that you want to sort of bring that energy into what you're doing.
Fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. Let's bring one more question up here. Let's see what we have here. Carlos Guzman, another fantastic drummer, a dear friend of mine, great, great player, and he's also a drum tech and production manager for Barry Gibb on the tours that they've been doing. He's a phenomenal. He's also is a drum tech for Max Weinberg. He's been around the block for sure. Hi, Tony. Can you talk about how it feels to play as a percussionist with a powerful performer like John Sagata and how you approach that particular gig?
Man, you know what? That's a great question. I actually never played percussion with John Sagata, but I did play drums. But the gig never happened. This is the craziest thing. It was in Jersey, and they sent me the music, the charts, everything. They sent me the whole show. As a matter of fact, the drummer that plays with him usually is David Shiverton, a great friend of mine, amazing drummer. And he couldn't do this with him, and they called me to do the one-off. And they sent me the music and everything. And, you know, there was a storm, and it was an outside gig. So I got lucky that I didn't have to do the gig because, I mean, it was going to be, a difficult situation. No rehearsals, no rehearsals. You got to come in and do the hit. And with a show like John Sagata, you know, you really have to hit it because the show is sort of like the versions are there. They're, you know, he's used to listening to a certain level and certain way of playing. And if you're a new guy, you really have to focus in on how the guy that was before you, how he played the show. I think this is a super important lesson to anybody that's coming into sub. You know, if you get called to do a gig, you really have to understand how the guy that was doing or is doing the gig, how he played the gig. Because when you come in, if you play your thing, you disregard whatever the other person was doing, it may feel awkward because everybody's used to listening to a certain way of playing the show. And it's really important that you try to at least play or sound like the guy that was there for the moment, you know, until everybody gets accustomed to what you're doing, or, you know, it makes everybody feel at ease, in my opinion. You know, if you just come in and do your thing, it might be shocking because, you know, a lot of times these shows, the artists are used to the music sounding in a certain way, you know, and we all have an approach. We all want to bring in our thing, and that's cool. But a lot of times you really have to try to just try to focus in what's necessary. And if you can try to emulate what the guy there before you was doing, it'll definitely help you make the thing feel good for everybody, in my opinion.
Well, that's fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. Well, this is great. This is great open-minded concepts that I want everyone to kind of take in, that, you know, being adaptable. And as always, Carlos, great, great question. Let's talk about Vater products. Now, you guys have been playing Vater for years. Fusion Acorn and the Sugar Maple Fusion.
Yeah, I love them. You know, my thing with Vater is I love the variety. You know, I actually play all kinds of Vater sticks. Hopefully one day I'll be able to zoom in on one particular, you know, style of stick or something that I can come up with, you know, hopefully. But because I play so much music in so many different styles, again, like I was saying before, a lot of times I have to switch around the stick, you know, that I'm using. With Ricky Martin, I usually use the HH220. From the Josh Freeze model. I love that stick. It's perfectly balanced for that style of music where I can hit hard and I can also be articulate, you know, when we come to the Latin music. I can get a good cross stick. It's a great balanced stick. It's not too heavy. It's right in the middle of a 5A and a 5B. It's perfect. But now I'm using the Session Acorn, I mean the Fusion Acorn, just because it's not as heavy, you know, and you know, this stick is great because I can do everything, you know, with a lighter touch. I get great articulation of the right cymbal if I'm playing jazz or even if I'm doing a recording session. It's a very well-rounded stick, you know. If I want a little bit more weight or oomph, maybe if you want to think about it that way, I will go to the Josh Freeze model or even some of the classics that I really like. The 5A classic is amazing. And, you know, I just like the variety. So I could, you know, go around playing Vater sticks all day long, you know.
and the maple is a little lighter feel, right?
Well, the reason why I play the maple is because of that. Just because it gives me more control. So the Sugar Maple Fusion really helps me to play stuff that it's lighter, because it's the stick is definitely lighter, but it's not thinner. So it feels the same, and I can actually play with way more control. You know, I can control the stick just because it's lighter. And actually the durability is amazing too. They don't break, you know, like maple usually does. Vater sticks are well known for that. You know, they just last forever.
Well, this is why Alan continues to do what he does. He makes such a great product, and it's just so consistent. He's so particular with putting out the best product that he can, and he always does, which is fantastic.
Absolutely. Props to him.
Jamo, when you're back there and stuff is happening backstage and stuff is going on, how do you focus on Tony when you have all these beautiful women that are dancing? How do you maintain that level of focus? That's really strong.
Well, he has me stand up behind him and video him for the whole night. So that's what it is. But it's actually pretty dangerous back there because all the dancers we had. In Vegas, we had, what, 8 guys and 8 girls, and the the backstage is kind of small, but there's a bunch of other people like moving in and out props and stuff like that. It's pretty dangerous, so you got to watch yourself. But no, I'm pretty much just hanging up behind Tony, making sure everything is solid.
Man, it's a rough show to be in. You know, I mean, I know Jamo. I mean, I'm freaking out about everybody up there because I mean, I've had stuff happen to me. In these shows, there's so much stuff happening, man. Technically, that you actually in danger a lot of times. So you don't even have that. You know, you have to really be very comfortable to even sidetrack to go and think about who's dancing or where's the girl in front of you. You know.
Yeah.
I had a lot of light. Stuff going on. I had a light almost fall on me one time. I don't know if you remember Jamo, I'm talking about a.
Oh yeah.
200 pound light. From somewhere, you know, up there, fell right next to me.
Yeah.
I mean, so it's not, you know, these shows are very intricate, you know, technically. And there's parts moving, there's elevators, there's lighting, there's all kinds of stuff that it's, you know, if you think about it, there's a lot of danger, you know, too, because people don't talk about that. But anything can go wrong. You never know.
Well, it's pretty powerful. You know, Tony, you in the early part of your career, you moved to New York.
I did, yeah.
What was that like to make that decision? You know, from Puerto Rico to Florida, now you're in the Apple. What was it like?
Man, I always, you know, wanted to go to New York. I knew that was the city to be in. Just the challenge of being in New York City, especially me coming from Puerto Rico. You know, I'm an island guy. I grew up here in Puerto Rico, and it's really a challenge, you know, to move to a city like New York. But my grandfather was born in New York, and I don't know, I had a thing with New York. Most of the musicians that I admire and grew up listening to, you know, they come from the New York scene. And again, you know, what I wanted to do was there. You know, I knew that, you know, I wanted to learn how to play jazz. I wanted to be able to improvise. I wanted to really understand that style of music. So I went to New York City, and man, I think it was the best decision of my life, you know. I really enjoyed it. I still think that New York City is a city for young people, man, because it's rough, you know. It, you know, to get in there and hustle, you know, you really have to have that edge as far as, like, being young and having the energy. But I think it's one of the most amazing music scenes. Unfortunately, you know, things are happening and things are changing as far as the scene and stuff, and there's a lot of incredible jazz clubs that have been closing down, the Standard, and you know, it's unfortunate that this is happening, because even though I
we lost your sound.
Even though I'm in Puerto Rico, I'm still very well connected to New York somehow. I'm always talking to friends of mine that are still in the city. Also, there's a lot of other young musicians that are coming from Puerto Rico that they ask questions. They want to know about New York City. And I'm trying to be that bridge to connect, you know. But New York City, man, it's the place to be. If you really are about the music, New York City is a great place to be and to learn and to be exposed. I've seen so many incredible musicians there, man, that's been like my school in a way. More than books or anything, it's just being out there, seeing all these people and being exposed to the different styles of music, being exposed to the level of musicianship that's there, man. It's really, you know, it opens your head to so many things, you know, musically speaking, that I suggest anybody, you know, everybody should go and experience it for sure.
Well, that's great advice. And New York, you know, like a roller coaster ride that it is. I live on Long Island. I'm about a 45-minute drive outside of New York, but I get into New York all the time. It is just action. It's energy. It's, like I said, it is a roller coaster ride. But there's still clubs like the Blue Note and the Iridium, some great, great clubs that are around that have great, great music going on to it.
Yeah.
Before we go out, I want to ask Jamo. Jamo, who were some of your drumming influences?
Oh, my gosh. The late, great Neil Peart. Without a doubt, I think pretty much anybody can say that he was an inspiration. Vinnie Colaiuta, Jimmy Cobb, yeah. Roy Haynes. When I was working with the Allman Brothers, we would have Peeking at the Beacon every March. And so we were playing at the Beacon Theater for about a month straight. And over that time, Roy Roy's birthday. And he always had a birthday gig down at the Blue Note. So Jamo, the other Jamo, and myself, we'd go down there and hang out with him. So he exposed me to a lot of wonderful players. Steve Smith, Dennis Chambers.
Wow.
Oh, my God. I mean, the list goes on. The names escape me right now, but the list is vast.
Well, you've got some great, great guys. And many years ago, when you were down at Third Bed Music and we did the Florida Drum Expo for 10 years every year, we had some of the greatest drummers in the world performing. It was pretty amazing that we had 5 to 7 of them on stage, and I was emceeing those. What great, great shows those were to meet all these great, great drummers.
Absolutely. And every year we had the best of the best there.
Pretty, pretty amazing time. Tony, who would you say are some of your drumming influences?
Man, there's so many. Again, like Jamo said, I mean, being from Puerto Rico, you know, there's all kinds of influences that you have. Starting when I started playing drums, a lot of local drummers were really important in my development of you know, playing the instrument. And more than anything, it was the exposure to different, you know, other drummers that are not from here. But again, you know, obviously, you know, Dennis Chambers, Simon Phillips was a big influence. Neil Peart for sure. Buddy Rich, you know, all these guys that, you know, a lot of jazz drummers, Tony Williams, Vinny for sure, you know, Elvin, you know, Jeff Tate Watts was a big influence in me. A lot of New York City drummers too were a huge inspiration. Brian Blade, obviously, Antonio Sanchez, Horacio, you know, there's so many, the list is incredible. Cuban drummers were also an influence. I mean, you name it, you know, there's so much music, you know, I'm exposed to so much that we can go on, you know, Jeff Porcaro, Alex Acuña, you know, I mean, all these drummers, Will Kennedy from the Yellow Jackets, actually my dad was a huge fan of the Yellow Jackets, and being a musician, I will always hear, you know, Will Kennedy. So, I mean, we can go and talk about so many drummers that have been an influence. Gregory Hutchinson, Jonathan Blake from New York, you know, Mark Juliana has been an influence. You know, all these guys still, to this day, I'm influenced by all these guys, you know. And definitely the Steve Smith and, you know, all those other guys, you know. It's anybody that's playing music nowadays, you know. It, you know, I always, like I said before, I try to go back into history. Mm-hmm. And you know, I'm actually, this is something that I don't like about technology nowadays, is that back in the day, you would get a record, you knew who was playing on the record, you look at it, you know, we don't have that anymore. It's so weird. I usually have to go to Wikipedia or something to see who's playing on the records, you know, the newer records. But, you know, when you go back, that's what I do. I'm like a music binge. You know, I get a record, I look at producers, I look at musicians, I look at where they were recorded. You know, like I, for example, a big influence on me that is not a drummer, Daniel Lanois, somebody that I admire as far as like the way that he creates sound, the way he approaches sound, you know, all these things are important, you know, not just the drumming community, but obviously, you know, they're all important. Terry Bozzio was, I was a big Terry Bozzio fan for a while too. I even have a picture of him when I was 14, I went to a drum clinic he gave at I think it was Thurber Music in Florida, as a matter of fact. I have a picture somewhere in my Instagram. But anyway, you know, so many guys. I've watched you play, Dom, too.
Oh,
so,
my God.
You know, it's like, you know, growing up, you see all these drummers, and because you appreciate the art so much, they all, you sort of like find what it is that each one of these drummers has that is impactful to you. You know, and you try to really, I try to appreciate that, you know. What is it that this person makes me feel when I see them play, you know? And instead of you know, talking, you know, BS, like, you know, like we say, I try to find what's positive about it. You know, what is it that this guy has that makes him stand out? You know, why is this guy so great? And anyway, so many influences, man.
Fantastic.
We can go on forever.
Fantastic. Well, it sounds like you both have an incredible open mind. But you both have really an open heart to take in this music and to listen to it and be influenced by it. This is absolutely fantastic. I want to thank you both for joining me.
Thank you.
Tony, Jamo.
Thank you.
You guys are fantastic.
God bless you.
Safe travels. Be well. And at some point, I look forward to seeing you guys in person for sure.
Absolutely, man. Great to be here.
I really
want to thank Vader and everybody in the family for, you know, making this happen. So glad to be here, man. And great to, you know, share this moment with you, Dom.
Thank you so much, guys. Stay Thank well, you. Stay safe, and we'll speak to you real, real soon. Thanks, guys.
Bye, bye, Dom.
Thanks. Boy, how fantastic, man. These guys, I can talk to these guys for hours, and just the information that comes in and all the people listening from all around the world. This is so great to have this opportunity. This is live on Facebook and YouTube, but it'll go back on the Vader YouTube channel. So go back there and you can check it out again and listen to all the different wise information that is being shared to us. Next week, March 9th, you got to check this out, man. We are going to have a great, great time with these drum techs. We've got Mike Ledesma. We've got John McGee, McHarry, and Tim Soyan. This is so great. These guys are going to be here. We're going to talk drum tech stuff and some of the challenges that are happening out, who they've worked with and what they've done. These guys have been on the road, man, traveling for everyone from Aerosmith to Cindy Blackman to, my gosh, Primus, you name it. These guys have been everywhere. So this will be a great, great talk and a good hang with these fantastic drum techs. So I thank you all so much for joining us on March 9th. This has been fantastic. I thank you all so much for joining me here today with Tony and Jamo. Great, great conversations. I enjoy doing these from my studio here on the North Shore of Long Island, a little town called Port Jefferson Village. We do this here. We have some fun. Great stuff. Thank you, Chad Brandolini, for making this happen. He's the guy back there producing all this stuff for me, letting me know that there's questions and information and stuff going on. And, of course, to Alan Vader and the Vader Company, thank you so much for making great product, inspiring us all. When we hold you in our hands, we are able to express what we do. Thank you all so much. Stay safe, wear your mask, wash your hands, and I'll see you real soon. Thanks. Bye-bye.